The Chinese People's Liberation Army, the PLA, invaded Tibet in full force in 1950, only a year after Mao completed the conquest of China proper and proclaimed that his 600 million Chinese had stood up after being subjugated by imperialists. Actually, they were subjugated by the Manchus, actually more than Europeans, for 300 years, but never mind that. They were particularly annoyed by the Westerners. He then, although the Westerners actually never really occupied China except for Hong Kong and Canton, otherwise they didn't, Guangdong, you know, otherwise they never really occupied it, not like they did India. He then began in systematic stages the communist attempt to consolidate its military conquest of Tibet and its occupation of the vast highland, and the forced imposition on Tibetans of Marxist materialism, communistic egalitarianism, and a slave-like focus on the work of this one physical life as a soulless biological robot in service of the dictatorship of the proletariat. He and his minion, main minion, Deng Xiaoping, for the Tibet conquest, waged an all-out assault over decades on Tibetan Buddhism. It was a Buddhistic culture, destruction of monastic institutions, monks and nuns included, scriptures, outdoor monuments, mani stones, prayer flags, personal rosaries and prayer wheels, icons, paintings, photographs of the Dalai Lama, even knowledge of the Tibetan language, and intensive communist thought reform sessions year in and year out for decades. They killed members of whomever they called upper classes, including wealthy peasants and classless nomads, because they had to create an upper class to get rid of, since the Tibetans didn't really have a very prominent upper class. They had like 40 noble families, mostly in the capital, and they didn't really have the parallel culture that the Chinese had, which Mao had been dealing with. In struggle sessions and forced redistribution of all forms of wealth left over after they took out huge amounts to support their Chinese troops and even send to other poor areas of Western China. They imposed Chinese language education and indoctrination in Maoist writings, Little Red Book, etc., enlisted most able-bodied persons in labor brigades, work gangs, production units, and so forth. The initial war of conquest and subsequent social upheavals, economic exploitations, and widespread famines caused the unnatural deaths of approximately 1.3 million Tibetan people by 1980, destroyed or uprooted all the architectural and artistic treasures of the nation, and eradicated the intelligentsia entirely except for a few people who escaped into exile after 1959 or who survived the prison camps until the 1980s. All of these measures failed to turn the Tibetans into Chinese communists, actually, and subsequent versions that are still going on even now are catastrophically failing as well, just producing more resentment in the local population rather than eliciting voluntary participation in China. Like the Dalai Lama says, it's a kind of demented policy if you have some person under your power and you beat them and say, you have to love me, you have to love me. It really, really doesn't work. So, Tibetan civilization mainly continues outside of Tibet, among the by now 150,000 Tibetans in exile all over the world, who have actually more or less thrived in exile because they have this sort of model inner modern consciousness, and therefore they can adapt very well to the machinery and the stress and the whole situation of the modern world. They can adapt. And even they keep their own culture in the midst of it as soon as they get a little bit of means going, which they did. The minute the Chinese occupation administration was distracted by the post-Mao reorganization in the late 70s and early 80s, the Tibetans rose up quietly during the 1980s and began to rebuild some monasteries, become monks and nuns, restore their previous social order based on their personal occupations and their talent, and travel to India to pilgrimage and receive initiations and teachings from the Dalai Lama and other teachers. The Chinese were astounded that such primitive thinking could have survived the three decades of the unremitting onslaught of military occupation, communist thought reform, and cultural revolution. The liberal policy of Hu Yaobang, Shi Zhongxun, and Zhao Ziyang in the early 80s was withdrawn by the mid-80s by Deng Xiaoping and the Central Committee. And those three were removed from power and actually disgraced for having made a mistake of being too liberal and too easygoing on the Tibetans. And Shi Zhongxun's father was completely thrown down into the doghouse. And the young Xi Jinping, who was at that time quite young, in his 20s, he was very upset about it at the time, it is said. But then the Central Committee, although they stopped any further liberalization, they rather uneasily acquiesced in the Tibetans' choices, even to choose this Buddhistic culture that seemed so backward to the communist Chinese, because the Chinese saw that once they rebuild the monasteries, they could make Tibet a tourist destination. And to do so, they needed some colorful monasteries that, you know, that which had been destroyed in the Cultural Revolution. And they needed quaint monks and ceremonies that are colorful and exciting, sort of like American tourists going to the Lakotas and seeing the Indian, you know, dances and ceremonies and getting all excited about these primitive people. However, when in the late 80s, the monks and especially the militant nuns began to, once they were getting their Buddhistic education and their philosophical and different kind of view of life than the materialist one, they began to make peaceful but energetic protests against the Chinese occupation. And that time, the party led by Deng cracked down very heavily in the late 80s and put even Tibet under military rule. And actually, the Chinese official who led that was Hu Jintao, who later was made president of China by Deng Xiaoping, by ordering Jiang Zemin to put him in after Jiang was finished as the next president, because he proved his worth to Deng by being very, very harsh and imposing military rule at the end of the 80s on the Tibetan people. So the Chinese thing about Tibet is a very important thing to the Chinese. It's this huge, it's like Jefferson acquiring the Louisiana Purchase from Napoleon. To them, it's a huge thing. But they know it's a little late in history for that sort of territorial acquisition. So they're always trying to make it seem like they always were there and it was always theirs. Meanwhile, no Chinese lived on the high plateau, period, until 1950, except the occasional visitor. Because you can't live there at that altitude. Your heart, you get chronic mountain sickness. Women will miscarry babies. They can't make placenta. Nourishing placenta out of 47% of the oxygen. So that's why Tibet was more or less empty of colonization for thousands of years. Only a few people with special chemistry can live there.